Back in the days, at the age of 16, I was living a life so cruel, nah man, robbing, stealing, dealing, crack cocaine, beating motherfuckers down, cause shit was the name. Withdraw from school because the shit was legit, took a motherfucking tree, and then I had to split. Shit was getting drastic, too hard to comprehend, I had to leave, kid, because my life was full of sin. I went back, and I did that shit again, and shit got worse, I was looking at the pen. I never thought my life could be so damn bad. Here I go living my life beside a fag, waiting and waiting and contemplating every day. I never thought that my life would be this way. Mad at myself, no one else to blame. Frustrated with life because the shit was getting lame. Confused at the time, my eyes became blind. Foul situation, I was drifting from behind. Calling my peoples, but no one heard my call. Living my life behind motherfucking bars. Now your minute day, it's going astray because I didn't obey. Fuck hip hop array. Not being disrespectful, but that's how I feel. Had to represent myself every day, it's chill will. Fuck the nonsense, there's a better way out. When you represent time and time without a doubt. Shit is getting strange, now I'm fucking detained. White man superior, got me fucking insane. I gotta bounce back and help my damn self. Cause if I don't, yo, I be fucking my damn self. I gotta take it how it come in, how it come, I will take it. Word is bond, it can't be no fucking faking. Shit is real, all times behind still. Doing stupid ass shit for the dollar bill. It's a setup. It's not a motherfucking game, it's a war. So I gotta maintain, I gotta maintain, I gotta maintain. Yo, we gotta maintain out here, man.
Hey, shalom, peace. Islam, Hotep, greetings to everybody that's actually made it apparent to actually tune in this evening. I have myself, Tanda Doc, and I also have Brother Ra Aki on the line. We decided to bring back another Creditors, Debtors, Contracts, and Commerce radio show. So, I mean, we'll be momentarily starting this. So with that being said, I'd like to always reiterate, like I do so often, this is not legal advice. There is none of the information that we're about to provide is legal advice. We do not offer legal advice. So please, do not ask either of us for legal advice. What we're about to provide is purely for informational, educational, and if you're one of those individuals that love to be entertained, entertainment purposes as well. And we do not engage, nor we do embrace polemics, which is the art of disputation. There's many people that just like to babble off and argue. So, I mean, we're going to briefly speak maybe on a few topics, and then we'll open the floor up for questions. So right now, your mics are probably muted. So with that being said, any of you that may be suffering from some type of commercial presentment, contract law that you may be going through, despite what you may think it be, everything that we deal with in our lives today revolve around contract law. Whether it's you taking your son or daughter to school, signing a contract, whether it's you registering for college, whether it's you paying someone to take you in a taxi, it's all involving contract law. It could be you standing up in a public venue referred to as a court, which we like to refer to as color of law courts. It's all involving contract law. So with that being said, I'm going to bring in the brother Ra Aki, you know, let him speak. And the brother's well-versed in, you know, natural healings to those of you out there that may suffer from any type of infirmities or illness. The brother may be able to assist you with that. So with that being said, brother, you there?
Yeah, bro, I'm here.
All right, got something you want to open up with, you could go ahead and do that. I'll come back in a little later, and then, you know, we could actually open it up for questions. I guess to, you know, get the people familiar with you, those that may not be, the brother is pretty well versed in commercial presentment and contract law. If you would, brother, you could give them a brief synopsis on, you know, what you actually do. And, you know, how you came into this contract law?
I've been studying contract law for, I'll say, a little over a year. But, you know, like us all, we've all been involved in it through, you know, registrations and other forms of contract. However, I began my journey, I started my journey when I started, you know, pretty much like most people that indulge in this realm, I was in debt, or what you call debt, or what most people perceive as debt. In other words, debt meaning, in the public's view, I owe money. So, I started getting notices and offers, you know, quote unquote, and I pretty much went into default. And, you know, after I went into default, I was in default for about 2 years. Messed my credit score up, you know, pretty much the basics of commercial robbery, if you will. And so I started studying. I started hearing about, you know, things like sovereignty and, you know, secure. Well, I heard the term secure party creditor a little later on. Months later, but as I, you know, discovered sovereignty, or what at the time when I learned about sovereignty, what it was is that pretty much that the laws that govern, or so-called laws that govern the United States, these laws don't apply to what you call the living being, or the flesh and blood man, or it goes by many names, the persona, propria persona, and all these other things. But I learned that these laws don't govern the man. Now, at first, when I heard of these things, I was like, okay, what does this mean? What do they mean by the living flesh and blood man? What does that mean? You know, so as I started going into research, I started looking into discovering what a corporation really was, what a corporation is, you know. So as I started studying more and more, now before all this, I was deeply involved in, you know, metaphysics, natural healing, and studying along those realms. So pretty much as I studied metaphysics, that was the foundation that I set for myself that introduced me to commerce, because they pretty much go hand in hand, because the commercial aspect of things, it comes from metaphysics, the same principles. So, yeah, after I started learning about what a corporation is, I understood that a corporation isn't a living thing, and I was confused at first, like most people that go into this realm. But I was introduced into this realm because I was in trouble. I felt like I was in trouble. So as I started studying more and more and more and more, day and night, losing sleep at that, at the least, I started to become wary of, like, because I used to work at a dead-end job, 9-to-5 job, but in my case, it was 2-to-11. And while I was at work thinking about bigger things, I thought to myself that there's something wrong here. I shouldn't be here. I should be doing something greater. There's something in me that's bigger than that. That's bigger than this job, or this job that you call a job. It's not work. It's slavery. It's not work. Work is different from a job and slavery, at least in my point of view, anyways. So while working, or slaving, if you will, I looked around at my peers and people around me that surround me on a daily basis. And most people are not up to date or don't have an understanding of what it is that's going on around them. The fact that the laws, or what you want to call laws, are not laws that bind you to anything unless it is you that gives your consent to be bound by it. So these laws are what you call statutes, ordinances, rules and regulations that are created by corporations to organize and structure, to keep together the infrastructure of the corporation. In this case, called the United States, not the constitutional United States, but the corporate United States.
Right.
Which are two totally different things. Because the corporate United States, the constitutional, was built by what you call the Republican. Okay, and that's the constitutional United States of America, or the States United on the America, or in the Americas, if you will. That was the constitution for the United States, not the constitution of the United States. Now, later on, the corporate, which was the democracy, was established, which it didn't necessarily abolish the Constitution, the original or the organic Constitution, but what happened was that people gradually forgot what the Constitution was, what the United States is, or the states that have become united. You see, not the United States, as we know now, governed by statute, is the corporate fiction that they have you to believe that you are obligated to, or you're obligated, you are compelled to comply. However, it's not you. That does not mean that you should go around running red lights and beating up on people and stealing and robbing and killing. That just means that these laws that are given, these statutes, are not you're not compelled to perform. It is your legal fiction that is compelled to perform. And once I understood that, that's what gave me an understanding of the difference between the real man, the flesh and blood man, the human flesh, which is, that's not me either. But, however, that between that and the corporate fiction, which was created at the day that I was born via the registration of live birth, which registered the name to create a trust that pretty much established a benefit for to me, to the public, and also to the private, which, you know, there's different types of trust, but it's through the legal fiction that they charge you. It's through the legal fiction that the police officer beats. He beats the living flesh, but only because, well, he would beat the living flesh even if he did assert your rights. Actually, if you assert your rights, you probably got a more chance of getting whooped on. But later on, see, we're in those times now when we can't worry about necessarily getting whooped on, because usually they want, if you know what you're talking about, that's the less likely chance that they will touch you, because you know your rights. They know that, yeah, oh, I'm a police officer, I'm going to beat you up now. And later on, since you don't know your rights, you don't know what's going on, all you're going to do is, when you get out of hospital, is go back home and do the same thing all over again. But if he approaches someone that knows their rights, oh, I can't beat up him. You know, I'm a police officer, I can't beat up him, because when he gets out of the hospital, oh, snap, he's going to have my bond, he's going to get me. Because he knows his rights as a living, or as a natural man or woman. Man, plural, a man being encompasses both man and woman. But however, anyway, back to pretty much, when I went into debt, I didn't understand that it was the legal fiction that was being charged, that the legal fiction was in quote-unquote debt, which once you become understanding of what that is, it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's not even a good thing. It just is. But when the legal fiction took out the loan, when the legal fiction took out the loan, and the legal fiction, though the legal fiction created the funds, but I didn't know that at the time, and most people don't when they do these types of these commercial process or these commercial act, this type of commercial activity. When I engaged in that realm, there were certain things that wasn't disclosed to me, and probably when I signed the note or the contract at the time, the person, the teller, or whatever they're called, the people that work at the bank, they probably don't know either. So you can't come up to them and you say, hey, you know, where's my note at and all that stuff. Those people won't know. You have no one to talk to. They won't even know what's going on. But when I was in debt, or quote-unquote debt, and that's another thing, they keep you in this cycle of worry because they have you fearing that you always have to pay back something or that you're always behind in something or you're drowning in debt or you're up to your neck in debt. They keep you at this constant fear of and worry that triggers psychological and neurological effects that affect you physically, mentally, and spiritually to keep you entangled in their web. And now, however, if you act as a creditor, if you are in a creditor's capacity, and creditor being one of many capacities, you could be a creditor, you could be a debtor, you could be a natural man, you could be a sovereign being, you could be a spirit. That's why your legal fiction, or that's why your persona is a transmitting utility, because it goes into one form of shape to another. So they keep you in this, but if you're acting as in the capacity of the creditor, you don't necessarily worry about things. What you do is to figure out what it is that is wrong or identify the problem. Once you identify the problem, you understand the problem. Once you understand the problem, you bring the solution. That's how creditors operate as. Now, at that time, I was not a creditor. Actually, I don't know what I was because I wasn't a debtor either, because I said, look, you know what? I ain't paying none back. Because I had a basic understanding that they didn't physically hand me anything anyway. So it was like, it's like a spiritual bondage that they tried to trap me in. Now, when you operate on the private side is the part that is where all originates from. It's the unseen side. Your legal fiction or that corporate fiction or that front, it's what is being used to participate or to move commercial energy. And that is what you use to, that's the entity that's in violation of the laws. That's the ones that get taxed because you're not being taxed. It's your name that's being taxed for the use of the property of the United States or whatever government that your legal fiction is under. So if you're being taxed, if you're being levied on, if you're being leaned against, it's all dealing in commercial securities and monetary policy and all that stuff. Now, as I started to begin to learn, and I knew that there was something bigger than what it is that I'm in now, because there's no way that I'm just supposed to get up and go to work every day, come back home, or work like a slave, get tired, come back home and eat, go to sleep, wake back up, get dressed, go to work, tire myself out again, go home, eat, and sleep, and do the same thing all over again. That's not, that's, that's there's something wrong with that, at least to my, in my opinion. So my next step was, you know what, there's a problem. Identify the problem. What's the problem? This system. Or not the system. Actually, it's not necessarily the system. The system is just is. It's not good or bad. It just is. It's what you do with that makes it, that balances or that leans to which polarity, whichever other polarity. So I have to understand the system, which means that I may not be able, I have to sacrifice stuff. Things like, well, I can't worry about, you know, necessarily where my next meal is coming from. Just know that if you identify the problem and know what the problem is, you will get to a solution. You will eat. You will drink. You will sleep like you want to. And rest, not just sleep. Not just close your eyes and wake up, but actually literally rest and rejuvenate and regenerate and recuperate. These things can only be done by losing this thing called fear or understanding what fear is as opposed to being cautious, which are two of the same, well, they can be, or fear and cautiousness is one thing, fear is one thing, caution is another thing. If you fear, that's because you're losing control of something. And if you lose control of something, you don't know what's going to happen if you lose control. Caution, meaning that there may be danger foregoing. So caution is the where you have patience to know when and what to do at what time and where and even why you should do it. So these two these factors come together, or they work. You're supposed to use these factors, use these things to make up a not a system, but a build an understanding of what it is that you're in. And growing up, I always wanted to know. I always wanted to understand things, and wanted to understand what it is that I'm in. And in this case, it's the system. And commerce plays a very big part because every time you look around, you're participating in commerce. Every time you look around, there's a commercial activity going on. You're going to the store with $5, and you're going to go to the gas station and exchange that for gas. That was a commercial exchange. That was a transaction. Now, or just like anything else, it's contract. I got this $5. I need gas. Well, what do you got for it? What you gonna give me for it? Well, I got this $5. Okay. But I'm only gonna give you this $5 if you give me $5 worth of gas, whatever that is, whatever, however much $5 of gas. Even though that's an illusion. But yeah, you give me $5 worth of gas, and here you got this. That's a contract. Or you created a contract. Now it's up to those two. Since you gave up your valuable consideration, the person at the other end has to give their valuable consideration, which would be you receiving what it is that you paid for. So if you don't receive what it is that you paid for, and, or for instance, you don't know how much $5 worth of gas is, he may give you $3 worth of gas. But you won't know the difference because you don't understand the system that you're in and how it works. So he takes $5, gives you $3 worth of gas. He makes a profit instead of there being an equal exchange. So what just happened? The books are unbalanced. The balanced books are not balanced. But, and then there's another account created where you put the extra funds the gas or whatever, that gas has to go somewhere. Can't just stay there, because if it does, then at the end of the day, the books aren't going to be balanced for that gas station. So they have to take those funds and put that somewhere else, or not funds, but the gas, or whatever, assets or whatever, it doesn't matter. I have to put that somewhere else and go get it later and wait a certain amount of time until you, who gave it $5, realize that you didn't get $5 worth of gas. So you have to go back and claim that gas that you didn't get. But if you don't, it's considered abandonment. So therefore, you can't get it back because once you abandon something, you lost that seat, whoever finds it next is theirs. Oh, that's my gas. Give it back to me. No, it's not. Where were you at? Why you wait so long to go come and get it? We can't even go back far enough to even figure out whether or not it's yours. So you're lost. But the guy at the gas station sold that gas or that whatever, that asset, that commodity to someone else outside of the public, somewhere in the private somewhere. And that's what happens when you get a loan. That principle, the principle, that analogy, that was an analogy for what happens for those who can decode it. Now, once I started to understand that, I'm like, hold on. So these cats just said that they gave me whatever amount of loan, dollars in loans, and they told me that this is, they made me look at a promissory note and say, here, yeah, I promise to pay you this amount of money in this installment for this amount of time, or yada, yada, yada. And if it's not paid by then, you know, this whatever. Default, you know, then from default go to foreclosure and the collateral or whatever. The collateral will be collected if you don't pay by this amount of time. That can scare someone when they go into default, because usually people don't think before they go into before they enter a contract. Most people do not think, and that's why society, that's why the system is messed up, because people do not think. They don't know the contract that they're going into, even though that the person that they're signing the contract with spells it out in clear black and white. So then again, I guess they're not necessarily obligated to tell you anything, because if they were to fully disclose to you, you'd be like, oh, well, I'm not doing that. Or you would know how to do it better, and they don't want you to do that, because if you were participating in commerce properly, they wouldn't get the extra funds that they get from the time that you fix your signature on there and turn it into a negotiable instrument, which then makes it a liquid asset security that therefore can be transferred into cash and deposited right back into their bank while you're paying them the installment fees or the interest that they're charging. So therefore, they make double of what it is that you came in there for in the first place. And you were the originator of those funds from the begin with, because all creation of money begins with the banks. It begins with the banks, but the bank itself cannot create the funds, because it's just a corporation like anything else. There is no more lawful money in circulation. Lawful money cannot be used. If you do use it, you go to jail, because that's what you call the gold clause. You cannot ask for any particular type of coin or currency, because if you do, if you ask for gold for payment, which is lawful tender, which is lawful money, that's true money. If you ask for that, you're going to jail, because they abolished that. They suspended the gold clause. You can no longer ask for real money. You can only create these funds. But it's you that creates the funds, not your legal fiction. Although it is the thing that you use to create it, because you need an account, you need something, because you need something to represent you in the United States for you to create those funds. You, the natural man, cannot represent yourself, or you cannot go to court. You cannot go upon someone. That's why every time you look on something, they send you is in all capital letters. Because that's the distinction between you and your fiction. It's the fiction that they're talking to. You're the authorized representative, supposed to be the one to accommodate for it, meaning that since it cannot move, since the corporation cannot move, it does not have arms and legs. You do. It does not have a mind. So the corporation cannot contract. It cannot sign anything. The signature is the memorization or the memorialization of that contract, which therefore gives it stability because no one has your signature. I can't sign your signature the way you do. Because if I did, that would be counted forgery. And that's against the law. So if you have your own unlimited credit to create funds, it says that in the law, you are the backing of the national currency because the currency is backed by the faith and credit of the labor of the people, of the nation. The nation is the people. And it's you who creates these funds. And now when I found that out, when I heard about things like House Joint Resolution 192, or what is it, 73rd or 74th Congress, June, whatever, 5th, 1933, which was, then became codified in U.S. Title 31, something, whatever, says that you cannot ask for any particular type of corner currency. The gold clause, you can't, because if you ask for gold, it's the gold clause has been suspended. It says in the Constitution that only gold and silver can pay debts. So therefore, since they took all the gold and silver and you can't pay a debt, every debt has to be discharged. All obligations are to be discharged upon payment, dollar for dollar. So instead of you paying the debt, you can discharge the debt or offset the debt. The offset to get rid of it, period. For the obligation. What is an obligation? An obligation just means it's something that it's pretty much in layman's terms, it's something that you're supposed to perform. You're compelled to perform something. That's what an obligation is. You're obligated to pay. But I can't pay. So if I can't pay, this is my obligation. My obligation is to pay you. But I can't. Because they suspended the gold laws, so I can't give you gold. You can't ask me for gold because you'll go to jail. And if I gave you gold, I'll go to jail. But gold is real money. It's the only way I could pay you anything. Because the Constitution, which is the supreme law of the land, says that only gold and silver can't be used for payment, but I can't give you that. So what do you have to do? You have to discharge it upon payment when I tender something to you. When I tender negotiable instrument to you, and you take that, deposit that. Not you, people out there. Okay, you don't try to do any of this stuff. This ain't legal advice. Like brother said in the beginning. But however, these things become deposited into accounts. All money is now is accounting. And since, like I said, again, since the gold clause has been suspended and you can't pay in lawful money, everything, every dollar is a mere bookkeeping entry. And that was said by the Fed themselves. And they know these things. They know these things. The bank you go to know these things. Not the bank teller, but the bank knows these things. Your financial institutions, your educational institutions, they all know these things, but you don't. So they take the credit that you create and they eat off of it. And you become poor while they get rich off of something that you created. I used to think that the United States, now, don't get me wrong. Okay, well, let's start with this. Back to the legal fiction. When you go to court, when you go to whatever, When you go to Mac, I don't care where you go, when you go to McDonald's and you get a Big Mac, and by the way, side note, I don't advise anyone to do that. But if you do, see, love you like a brother or sister, but if you did do that, you participate in the commerce. What is commerce in layman's terms? Commerce in layman's terms is the activity, the transactions between two sovereigns. Now, the thing about that is that because earlier on I said that corporations can't sign contracts, so therefore they can't make a transaction. But it's not, since you're the front, you know, you have a front, which, you know, the sovereign citizens call a straw man. The straw man is the front. It's the front because it is the one that you put forth to only deal in transactions or in whatever you call it. You pretty much, that's what you use to participate in the transaction. Because it's not you, the living man or woman, using the Federal Reserve note that you call a dollar bill. Keyword note. What is a note? A negotiable instrument. What is a promissory note? It's a note. It's a promise to pay. Because why? Because only gold and silver can be used as money to pay debts. Give me a dollar bill. You just gave me the debt. Now I'm going to go get the debt to someone else. No one got paid. It just got moved around. And if you're not hip to what's going on, if you're not up to speed, literally, if you're not up to speed, I can't be any literal than that. If you're not up to speed, you will get caught up. And you will get bagged up in debt because you weren't up to speed with the economy and all this stuff to keep the debt going or to get rid of it via offset, discharge. So anytime that you participate in an activity, you participate in the commerce, but it's not you participating in the commerce. You are the mind. That's why they came out the movie The Wizard of Oz. You know, you got the straw man, didn't have a brain, and all that stuff. And they all played their parts. Don't ask me about, the moral behind it. I haven't really looked into it like that, but the straw man, the straw guy, which didn't have a brain, couldn't think, perfect example, dead. Try to take your brain out and walk down the street. You wouldn't go anywhere because without it, you'll be doing the body would be, unusable. So when you take the straw man and you as the puppeteer navigate with it through commerce, Michael Moore, the Navigator. When you use that legal fiction as a vessel in the seas of commerce to navigate and to avoid pirates, and to when pirates try to aboard ship, you have something called your rights as weapons. You see? Because you are the lifeline. You are the captain of that ship. But somehow you have abandoned it, as the metaphor goes, the analogy goes. You have somehow abandoned it, or you have been inactive, so you seem as if it's abandoned, but you have to wake up because you got to understand something. Your name that's attached to these registrations, trust. They are they can be a security agreement, but they are assets because paper is the new money now. Don't try to go write money on a sheet of paper and call it money. Don't do that. This is not legal advice. I'm not telling you to do anything. I do not know anything. All I'm doing is sharing with you what I've seen so far. However, since the money or the paper is the new money now, and another thing, admiralty or what you call common law. Common law, for most of us know, common law to be, common law is the law of the land, or pretty much what common law is if pretty much contract is law. When you have a contract, you just created law. If you and I come to agreement on something, if I say, hey, what you think about that, and you agree with me, boom, we just created law. Because we had an agreement, we had a meeting of the minds, and we had equal consideration. What was the equal consideration in that contract? Your agreement. You gave energy to that subject. You gave energy to that subject. Just like you give, excuse me, just like you give energy to your subject. What is your subject? What is a subject? Subject in this conversation or in this dialogue means a citizen. You give energy to your subject, your citizen. You're the sovereign. A subject is a citizen that adheres to the sovereign. The sovereign makes the laws, and the subject obeys them and complies with them. And if he does not comply, or if it, or whatever, does not comply with it, then it becomes penalized. It becomes gilded.
Sure. So, I was agreeing with you. So, I'm going to speak a little bit, brother, about, you know, getting hired without a social security number. There may be some listeners out there that may be interested in this topic. Really appreciate you putting the information out there that you did, and hopefully, you know, it will be useful to some of the people out there, maybe some new listeners. I see guest 8 putting a lot of information in the room, and we appreciate that as well. So I just want to briefly talk a little bit about getting hired without a social security number, and then we'll open the floor up for questions. Again, you're tuned into Creditors, Debtors, Contracts, and Commerce. We'll probably be giving this show like every week or every other week. We used to run this show about 2 years ago, but shut it down. Now we've decided to reopen it. So getting hired without a social security number. I've done a few videos regarding this particular topic on YouTube. Now, I don't like to use the word person, but since I'm talking to you people, I'm going to use the word person because I'm speaking in common parlance. If I'm using the legalese, then be mindful of that. But I'll just say every man or woman hoping to be hired actually needs to actually understand that most employers are actually hiring employees because those employers want to make more money. That's why they're hiring you. Now, for that reason, employers need to hire a person that will actually produce at a level that makes the employer more and more money than they spend as a result of hiring that particular person. So it's relating back to what the brother was talking about. They work you to death. They overwork you. You're overwhelmed with work, many of you. Many of you going in these jobs, it's not enough money. So instead of working 8 hours, you work 12, you work 16, you go home, sleep 6 to 8 hours, and it throws your cycle off balance because you get up and you do the same thing again for approximately 5 days. Some of you do it 6 days, and then you have all of these interpersonal problems within your relationships, and you don't understand what's going on. This is actually strategically designed by approximately 3% of the population that's controlling 97%. And 97% of the population has no clue of what's going on, despite your prestigious degrees in these institutions of higher learning.
you've still been deceived. So these employers need employees who are not only productive, but honest to them, that is, reliable and diligent as well. Now, additionally, these employers don't hire people who might bring other problems to the job. They don't want someone there that's informing you about what's going on, so on and so forth. In fact, in the workplace now, you're not allowed to discuss certain issues. You know, they don't want, you know, you talking about the Internal Revenue Service and inquiring about that on your job. So a potential employee, you actually need to comprehend that given equal or even a slightly better skills, an employer who actually understands their right to hire you and actually the legal protection actually provided to him is still likely to actually hire an unenumerated employer. And if you don't know that, I suggest that you Google that word, an enumerated employee. Now, as a person who actually decides to assert your legal rights, not to actually obtain, if this is your choice, because you always have a choice. There's always a choice. Some people say, no, I didn't have a choice. You always have a choice. You always choose what you're going to do, ultimately. So we're not suggesting that you do anything. We're not providing any type of legal advice. We're just facilitating information. So you always have a choice. So you have the right not to obtain the use of a Social Security number if that is your will. So if you haven't already, and the vast majority of you under the sounds of our voice right now most definitely are using a Social Security number, but you still can learn that it's rapidly becoming increasingly difficult to live free because these politicians are catching on. The more people that wake up, the more difficult they're actually trying to make it for we, the people. Now, in many ways, you must actually exercise a greater responsibility in your various personal, legal, and civic duties than most of these so-called Americans do. Now, unlike these other Americans, you realize that you are totally responsible for your actions. We're not responsible for your actions. We're not responsible for your future. You are. So you're responsible to pay all of your taxes that you owe, and you realize that you must prepare for your own retirement and so on and so forth, and cannot collect security or medical benefits and so on and so forth, whatever, you know, the issue may be. But most enumerated people believe that the United States, that many of you refer to as America, life is too difficult without a Social Security number because that's been embedded into your thoughts. And what you think most, that's what you believe. So you believe that it is too difficult to live without a Social Security number. And, you know, so you've actually surrendered, you willingly surrendered your rights in return for government Social Security in your said old age. If it's available then, and I don't think it will be. So you can actually more easily, brothers, sisters, decide what's actually important to you, you know, after reviewing this information. But don't believe us. Go and check it out for yourselves. But, you know, I always encourage people to research everything. Don't believe anything that I say or anyone else says. Go and check it out for yourselves. Now, one of the first things you would essentially have to do is negotiate with the prospective employer, whoever that may be. You know, so many of these unenumerated employees believe that they must work under the table for low wages. Now, you know, there's a lot of people that come here to do this. And a lot of employers treat people as such. Now, this assumption has essentially caused a lot of unnecessary hardship for many naive people and actually has resulted in tremendous savings for these true employers. This is just the truth. So this assumption is absolutely incorrect. It's just the people don't know any better, and they do not know law. And I'm not talking about their color law system. They do not know law. Employers who actually hire unenumerated employees have fewer payroll deductions, which actually result into approximately 20 to 40% savings for each employee and lower operating overhead. So they're getting paid hand over fist when they pay these people lower wages. So, and it's simply because of the saving, employers should actually pay unenumerated workers more than their enumerated counterparts. Now, of course, they don't do that, and they probably won't want to do that, but to be fair, they should, because they're making more off of these type of employees, but the employees are not, or they don't, they're not aware of it. They're not aware of it, but they need to recognize that you do not enjoy many of the so-called benefits, such as the unemployment compensation if you're an unenumerated employee. So therefore, it is very reasonable that you should actually negotiate a pay that is at least 20% above these enumerated peer employees. But no one's doing that. None of them's doing that. So the employer should actually find this more of a comfortable compromise. But now, with that aside, you would actually essentially discover that it is very difficult to find employers who will actually take the time to learn about hiring these unenumerated employees. And for those that do learn, few would actually have the courage to do it because of the way that the system is set up. So there are basically two ways to approach this situation. The first way is to simply go to a prospective employer and fill out the employment application as any other potential employee would. Now, with a pencil or a pen, you write a note in the Social Security number fill, you know, that's actually requesting your Social Security number. And this is actually not legal advice. It's just for informational purposes. Necessary information provided upon offer of employment. You're right in the section. Am I telling you to do that? No. I'm just facilitating information. Now, you would need to overwrite the area a bit to fit all of that in. But the personnel will usually assume that you have your reason for writing it. Now, if they ask, just simply tell them that since the information isn't really needed until you're hired, and this is according to 26 CFR 611B2C6, and you should be writing that down. Now, that for security reasons, you would like to withhold that information until it becomes absolutely necessary. And they will usually agree. I mean, it's what they refer to as law. It's their UCC codes and so on and so forth. So this would actually permit you to proceed through the interview process and to receive a real employment offer. So if they do not offer to hire you, it is because they found someone that they feel more comfortable with and not because of the Social Security issue. Understand that. Understand that. So when they do make an employment offer, it is because you are actually a qualified candidate that they want. So soon after their employment offer, they will ask you for a Social Security number. So now you have an opportunity to explain why you don't have one and how they should proceed. So hopefully the legal department will actually study the issue carefully and make the necessary arrangements, because what you're doing is perfectly lawful. Now, you may offer copies of the appropriate forms available, and you should actually be willing to sign, you know, those agreements. Now, if they fire you, then you know, or you should know clearly, that it is because they chose to discriminate against you for being unenumerated. So you might wish to proceed with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission or in court if they decide to fire you over that. And the second method is that is to briefly explain your unenumerated status in a cover letter accompanying your resume when you send it into it. So you will get very few positive responses from your resume, but those that do come back will be extremely promising because they understand the issue before interviewing you. So the process is most effective when you have used or have useful, necessary skills. So it is also best received by smaller employers in smaller communities than these large employers. But don't use a false Social Security number. Don't do that. Don't use a false Social Security number. I just wanted to put those two methods out there. You know, I could go on, but I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to open it up and see if people have some questions. For Leroy Key, you got anything else that you wanted to add? Or if not, yeah. I'm going to just open up for some questions here.
Yeah, I just wanted to say something before you did that. It's kind of a disclaimer almost, but anyway, first of all, whatever it is that most, wherever you hear from, I don't care where it is, whether it's at a seminar, if it's on an audio like this, anywhere, online, YouTube, whatever it is, you should always do your due diligence, which means to study for yourself as to what it is that you're getting yourself into. Don't, I know I said earlier about, you know, jobs and slaving and stuff like that, but don't go quitting your job tomorrow because of what I said today. I am not liable for that. I would not take any credit for that. That is your own doing if you do that. Don't do that. Why? Because you have to think strategically. Don't get emotional and excited because you know there's a better way. And even though there may be, I know there's people out there that work long hours and do these things and stuff like that, that what needs to get out. But you have to do it strategically because if you don't, everything could fall on you and against you. So, for instance, you quit your job today and then you go file all these documents and you do all this stuff. And next thing you know, you got people knocking at your door. You got all this other junk, all the letters coming in and stuff like that. How are you going to handle these things? The people knocking at your door, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. It's not to scare you. But what would happen? What would you do if that were to happen? Ask yourself that. If you get a letter in the mail saying that you owe money or you're doing something fraudulently, how are you going to respond? Because you have to respond, because if you don't respond, that's what you call dishonor. And if you're in dishonor, you lose. First one who leaves the battlefield first loses the war. So how are you going to respond to these things? If you feel uncomfortable or if you're thinking about it, like, yeah, you know, he's right. I really don't need to be working. Something better than this. He give me motivation. But I'm not ready to quit because I don't know what I'm going to do after I quit. If you don't know what you're going to do yet, if you don't know what your next step is, if you haven't studied it, study it first before you make any steps towards that particular thing. Because if you step into it without doing these research, the research that is required for you to understand what it is that you're getting into, you could be walking into anything blindfolded. And it won't go like you want it to go. That's just how things are. That's not because I said it. It's just how it is. So do your due diligence. Do your study. We all have the same mind. We all have a mind. Not the same mind. Well, we all have a mind. Put it that way. We all have a functioning brain. And we all have the same, we all have the same potential to do these things, but it won't happen in a day. It won't happen in a week. It may not happen in a month, but it will happen provided it is that you study enough and you do your own research. I keep saying that over and over again. Do your research, because I'm telling you now, whatever it is that anyone does because of what anyone else says, the person who said it is not liable. It's the one who does things that is held accountable. And it's the one that gets in trouble that was held accountable that tells on the person that told him or her and gets that other person in trouble because that person did something they weren't supposed to do or you did something you weren't supposed to do. So I just want to say that because there's a lot of information out there. This information is powerful, and it is. It can be used as a route to your freedom, commercial freedom anyway. It can be used for commercial freedom, but you got to play your cards right. You got to know what you're doing. You have to study, study, study. Study thyself, study thy enemy. Yeah, that's all I want to say about it.
Yeah. Appreciate that, brother. Anybody that's actually been asked to actually fill out an INS form, I-9, you know, I think I discussed this in an earlier video that I actually put on YouTube. Like, most employers will actually incorrectly apply the INS, I-9 form requirements on, you know, most employees and new recruits at their organizations. But you could always use their law against them. Like 8 U.S.C. 1324 Alpha clearly applies this issue to, like, knowing the alien is an unauthorized alien and actually merely defines its application and associations and order textuals with the employers to the form, labor, or contract, and so on and so forth. So, they ask you, you know, if your job application is actually in the fill of, you know, some type of agricultural business or anything like that, you might simply want to comply with the employer's request, you know, of course. But if you're like a natural-born man, a woman, then you may lawfully protest the issue if you wish. But, you know, you gotta assert good judgment. You got to use your judgment and do what's the best for you, you know. Because, you know, we're not going to coerce you into doing something that, you know, I might have done or someone else might have done. You got to decide what's right for you. And, you know, as the brother was saying, like, if you don't have some type of finances, like, you probably shouldn't just up and quit your job, though there's people that are actually going to do that. They just quit the job and they don't have anything else to do. But, you know, the way that they're working, most of the people is like just, they're keeping the people discombobulated with work, and then they stress them out with commercial presentments, traffic citations, child support, high mortgages, foreclosures. I mean, it's all, you know, to keep you totally discombobulated. But with that being said, we're gonna open up the floor. We're gonna go to the caller in North Central Kentucky. Do you have any questions, caller? You have any input that I would like to provide?
No, I'm enjoying the call. I'm going through. They call it a foreclosure. I call it a strategic default. My mortgage was sold like 4 times, and I just stopped paying it, and I challenged them. So they called us. They issued a foreclosure suit back in August, and I went and put a dispute letter on the record in the court case as soon as I got it. And this is their third continuance. They keep asking the judge for more time to answer my debt validation letter, which they can't answer. And, you know, it's crazy because it's obvious that these people are doing some fraudulent stuff, but the judge keeps giving them 30 days. Then I put in a to default them out. Then they'll put in a motion for another continuance, and they keep, this is like their fourth time, and it's just, you know, you know when you call these people on this stuff, and then you got these fake courts that just comply with these people, it's kind of discouraging, you know.
Right. So I mean, okay, the judge has actually given them more time, and then once the judge gave them more time, how did you respond to that?
Well, I went to court. The last time I showed up to court, and, well, I go every time, but, you know, the judge look at me, and I'll say, well, Your Honor, according to the law, they have 30 days to respond. And like this last time I told her, I said, it's been 120 days for them to respond to something. And I told her, I said, this needs to be dismissed.
No, understand this, brother. Just simply saying that this needs to be dismissed, he's not hearing that. You understand? You have to put something on the record. You know, when your initial document that you put on the record, you should have specified an amount of time that you actually gave them to respond. If they didn't respond, okay. If they didn't respond in a specified amount of time, then what's your next action?
Well, I wanted to put a motion to dismiss, but I was told that you don't put in motions.
Yeah, I wouldn't enter a motion because a motion has to be seconded by the judge. If the judge comes in and say, you know what, I'm not going to approve this motion, then it's not going to be dismissed. When you put that motion in, you're basically asking the judge to do something for you. A man doesn't do that. A woman doesn't do that. Yeah.
Or make a demand.
Right. I mean, you require. Require means to demand by authority. So you require that the case is to be dismissed. I mean, since you stipulated a specified amount of time in your original document and that they didn't respond, what I would have done is enter a notice of default. I would give them two notices of default, then I would actually move to have it thrown out. But you have to move the court. The judge is not going to do it for you. And essentially, he's supposed to be there just for, an official, a referee anyway.
As a referee.
Right.
But it's obvious that they don't have any standing. And,
right.
You know.
And they know that, but they're trying to let you screw it up. But you have to enter a default judgment against them. And then if the judge, doesn't respond accordingly to that, then I would contact the circuit court judges and get him put in his place.
Okay. All right. Okay, well, I'll yield the floor and continue to listen. I enjoy the show.
All right, brother. Thank you. A caller from South New York. West Tennessee, caller from West Tennessee. You have any questions? Do you have anything you like to state? Caller from West Tennessee. What about Southeast Florida, Monroe County?
Yes, sir.
How's it going, brothers?
I was over here listening, and I gained a lot from this little session we had. I gained more than I thought I was going to gain, honestly.
Right.
I had questions earlier, but they were already answered.
All right, that's good. It's good. So, I mean, you got anything you want to add? It's always good to hear something like that, man.
honestly, it did clarify a lot. It clarified that pretty much, like, it is what you make it. Like, the system's there, and if you don't know how to use it, they're going to pretty much bombard you, man. They're going to get you. So you just got to be on your P's and Q's. You got to know what you're talking about. And hopefully there's a lot more shows like this. I just want to be up to par.
Right. Yeah, like I said, I mean, we should do this show about 2, maybe 3 years ago, but just stopped it for a while. But you decided to bring it back. But yeah. It's okay,
brother. I did gain a lot, though.
All right. All right, that's good. That's good. I mean, we're gonna eventually be doing seminars, you know, like pretty much throughout the United States, you know, traveling to, you know, some states. People have certain venues that they, you know, want us to come and do a seminar. And,
okay.
You know, we're going to be doing that. And as the brother was speaking earlier, you know, he's into healing. You know, he's definitely helped certain people with certain illness that they have by using all natural remedies. You know, so, I mean, we're about that life also, you know, trying to.
Okay,
you know,
definitely. I got a brother here.
Holistically
now,
heal
him,
people. Yeah, I mean, it could be high blood pressure, you know, diabetes.
Right.
Things of that nature. You know, digestion issues like that as well. But thank you for calling in, brother. We're going to go over to North Mississippi. Caller from North Mississippi, have any questions?
Hi, I'm calling from North Mississippi.
How's it going, sister? Yeah, we
can hear you. Everything is going well. I came in a little late, but I just love it. I mean, I feel like when we're talking about this, it's important to mention the history. And my thing is with these traffic tickets, I have spoke with you on Facebook, asked you a few questions about it. So I did try the administrative processes, and what I did was basically write a letter to them, you know, and just stated, you know, about the name, and then I just let them know, you know, my status. And they kind of ignored me, but I kind of paid someone to write me another letter, and they just telling me to refuse, you know, the consent. And it's just like a current process. Like you said, the judge is like the referee, so it's like you going back and forth, and they want you to keep responding and see if you really know what you're talking about. Because I do feel like from where I'm at, it's not too many people that's going the sovereign route, but I do feel like people should do more webinars, like, you know, for us that's just coming into this. So we just won't be out here like, hey, I'm going to throw this letter out here and see if it works, you know, whereas we can actually, you know, purchase, you know, things. And I really don't have much to say, though. Like, I'm still learning. So like you said, I study every day, you know, I try to learn something new. But that's my thing, is these tickets, is playing with them with this traffic.
So you have a move-in violation, or was it a parking violation?
It's a move-in violation. And I actually, one of them I had got was the camera ticket. And I'm just like, I know that, you know, I didn't do that. So it's like, I don't know how to, you know, I'm not going to argue with them about this thing on camera thing, you know. And so I had asked the lady about it, and she gave me a letter sent to them or whatever, and I sent it to them, but they responded, you know, but they still wanted money, and I'm just like, gosh.
Okay, what lady are you talking about?
Her name is Courtney Cole. She actually does the debt elimination packages, but she also does different little things if you ask her about it. Like, she got a ticket, you know, a letter for the tickets and stuff, and that's what I purchased from her, and just use that.
And was the letter affected? I mean, she just sent the letter in?
No, like I say, the letter was like, I did it in the Fifth Judicial Circuit Court at the top. And I did state of, you know, what state I'm in. I put my name, verification of complaint, the state of Mississippi, County of DeSoto. I wrote before me, personally appeared, Olympia, the middle Logan, all caps.
So, you know, just a little note for future reference. We
mm-hmm.
do everything in the heading of an affidavit.
And oh, okay.
The reason being so is because an affidavit is an oath. So
right.
An unrebutted affidavit stands as the truth. Like you said, they've
right.
been ignoring you. So if
yeah,
you file that, under the heading of an affidavit and they don't respond, then your response is to move the court to dismiss the issue. I love it when they ignore me. I mean,
right.
because that's agreement. Acquiescence is agreement. So
right.
it's the same way, and people need to actually embed this into their thought patterns. Like, if someone sends you a commercial presentment and you ignore it, then that's agreement. That's acceptance.
Mm-hmm.
You
right.
go into dishonor. It's
mm-hmm.
the same procedure on the reverse side. If you send them an affidavit of truth or an affidavit of fact, That is a sworn statement. That means you've done that under oath. So if they don't respond, you know, you give them X amount of days to respond. Like I was telling the other brother, if they don't respond, now they're in the fault. They're in agreement with it. So then you move the court to dismiss it, and the matter's done. It's just that simple.
Cool. I'm sure writing that down.
Yeah,
I love
like
doing
that.
It. Like, I really, I think it's like, to me, it's kind of entertainment at the same time. It's just real because I always live this way. Like, I always been like, you know, like, I'm going to learn how to, you know, talk to y'all, you know. So now it's like, yeah, let's get it. Like, you know, so I like trying these things, but I need to do what's right because they will, you know what I'm saying, put me in a federal prison and I ain't know what I did. So I'm going to write down the affidavit of truth and all that.
Yeah, I wanted to add on to that, actually. First of all, when you go into a courtroom, what's happening is you have to understand that all crimes are commercial. So, therefore, you're stepping into a statutory court of commerce, pretty much. The judge is pretty much acting as a banker, and you have to deposit, pretty much, you have to make a deposit. Now, I'm going to give you a couple of examples, like out of Black's Law Dictionary, 10th edition. Ticket, a certificate indicating that the person to whom it is issued or the holder, which is you because you got the ticket, is entitled to some right or privilege. Okay? Now, a ticket, according to Black's Law, is a certificate. Now, what is a certificate? Certificate is a document certifying the bearer's status or authorization to act in a specific way. So, on the ticket, they're telling you that you have to pay. So, what did I say earlier? If you heard earlier, there's no way to pay.
Right.
Because there's no gold and silver in circulation.
Right.
So, they have to discharge the debt, or you have to discharge the debt. You have to learn how to do that, first of all.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the ticket itself is a bill of exchange, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to take that bill of exchange, and you have to pretty much deposit it.
Yeah, like a special value and all those things?
Yeah, so along that line.
All
now,
right.
Now, like I said, do your studies first, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Do not act first before studying. But remember, a certificate is a document certifying the bearer's status or authorization to act. So a certificate, which is that ticket, is telling you that you have authorization to tender payment to the court. And that's why you would use the ticket itself. Because the ticket is pretty much a check.
Gotcha.
Okay. So when you go into the court, now, if you want to get it, you know, if you didn't do anything, as you said, if you know, if it was misunderstanding or whatever it is, you send in, what I would do anyway, I would send in an affidavit with the with a conditional acceptance given the plaintiff. Or first, I would ask for the original charging instrument. Ask for the original charging instrument. If they could provide that, then I would go from there and, you know, pretty much offset it, discharge it. If they cannot, then I would put the burden back on the court to prove that I did these things or to prove that this is that. I conditionally accept to pay this ticket upon proof of claim that you could provide evidence that I did this or whatever, something along that line.
Yeah.
You back that up by affidavit. I would back that up by affidavit with, and back the affidavit up with your supporting evidence. I would back it up with my supporting evidence, such as the laws or whatever. If the person was in the wrong, if you could find anything along that line. But yeah, you don't want to damage the public, so to speak, when you go into the court by arguing and stuff like that, because immediately you'll go into dishonor. Because you're not going to court to – when you go to court, the judge, as you all said earlier, is a referee. the judge and the guy, the brother that had the mortgage issue that sent stuff to go send this to. The judge does not do anything. All the judge does is make the judgment. If the plaintiff or the prosecutor says, oh, yeah, you did this, you did that, you did that, and you don't respond, then it is by tacit acquiescence, that's what it's called, meaning that you agree to those allegations. So if you agree to those allegations, you go into what you call default and dishonor, and that's how you lose. So the judge, when you go to court, they're not trying to, they're not looking, you, most people think when you go to court that the judge is making the judgment based on who's guilty. He's not. He's making the judgment based on who goes into default first, because the maximum law says that he who leaves the battlefield first loses the war.
Yeah, the problem with her, I mean, she's done hers. She's used an administrative remedy. She actually hasn't physically gone into court. So, and I suppose that they've actually been sending those back to you. Is that it?
Yeah, they actually, it's getting pretty ugly. They're trying to revoke my license now. So I'm like, okay, maybe I done lost this one. I had to pay in and try to learn how to do it right this time. Cause
how
now
much
they,
is it?
This one they won, and they didn't say how much I owe on this. They just saying,
well,
I mean,
you know, it doesn't really matter how much it is. I mean, the citation is the original charging instrument. Now, I would simply just discharge the matter. I wouldn't deface it, but I would simply just discharge it. That's what I initially would have done. Instead of just sitting in some letter, I would have actually just discharged it and moved on from there. And they actually received payment. But I don't want to spend too much time on this. But we're going to actually try and move to another caller here. But thank you for calling in. We're going to move over to Central New Jersey. Caller from Central New Jersey, you have any questions or you have any input that you would like to actually add to the call? Caller from Central New Jersey? Well, I moved that caller back. Caller from New York, you have any questions? What about guest five? Guest five,
hello?
Do you have any questions? How is love?
Shalom, Todd. Shalom, Ra.
Hey, shalom, shalom.
I got a question. It's a little bit on a, well, I mean, it's a kind of a connecting topic, but I was watching one of your videos earlier today from the 16th and the 17th. It was one with you on FOPE.
Oh, yeah, yeah, this weekend. I was over in D.C., yeah.
And watching that video, I took down a note. I couldn't figure out how to spell it, but during the middle of the video, you spoke on how the, well, how I like to call it, the new 13th Amendment, since they, you know, they burnt the first one or whatnot, how that didn't actually free the slaves, but you said a word, it sounded like you said Gunther or whatnot, some war, the Gunther War.
No, the
and I was
Gullah
trying to
Wars.
That
the Gullah Wars. The Gullah Wars.
Gullah. You can spell
yeah,
that Gullah. For me?
It's the Gullah Wars. Yeah, I have a video on that, like on YouTube. And
okay.
I go to my channel and Google the Gullah Wars. It's G-U-L-L-A-H, Gullah. Like, G-U-L-L-A-H. I mean, those essentially were the wars that actually really freed the slaves. And people think Lincoln did it. It's because that we fought so many, like, wars against these people, they decided to free us. But, I mean, that's kind of like written out of their history.
Okay. Okay. Yeah that's what I was calling back because I couldn't figure out nothing. I guess I was spelling it wrong. But you already got a video, so I'm going to go peep that.
Yeah, I have a video on that. If I find it, I'll drop it in the room. I'll go look it up. But, yeah. So, I mean, but go ahead, brother.
Yeah, besides that, I was looking into, because I started for my SPC packet. You already did me one, and I had a little mistake or whatnot, but I'm working it out. One question I had about it is I was doing a little bit more research about how to continue I had talked to you one time. You told me because of a situation that it's better for me to be a secure party creditor than to try to go sovereign or whatnot and go live out in the middle of the jungle.
Well, I mean, the whole thing with being sovereign, man. It's, I mean, people are not getting this. Like, a lot of these people are using terminology, you know, making themselves like, I don't know, like an oxymoron. They call themselves sovereign citizens, and which is, like, impossible. If you're sovereign, you're not asking to get it, the government.
A subject at the same time.
You're not asking the government for anything if you're sovereign. You're not asking for any food. You're not using any kind of benefit. You're not asking to get it, to send your children to public school, anything. That means you're living totally free on the land. Like these people that's calling themselves free men on the land, that's what that is. It's like you have your own community, and you're not accepting any sort of government benefits. Very few people are capable of doing that in this day and age, which is why we suggest that you become a secured party creditor, which is different because you're still operating in commerce, but you're using your corporate construct as your corporation. You're just taking charge of your corporate construct, and you thereby become the authorized representative of that corporate construct, of that straw man, title you want to put on it. And that's why you become a secured party creditor, because, I mean, there may be times like, say, if you want to fly. I mean, if you're sovereign, you're not flying anywhere. I mean, you don't have any governmental ID or anything like that. Or if you want to rent a car or something like that. If you're sovereign, you're not doing that because you don't have any of their government IDs, anything like that. You don't have a driver's license or anything like that. There's some people that told me, yeah, I want to totally get rid of my driver's license. Well, I tell them, well, I don't, because I choose to operate in commerce. You know, I need to be able to operate on the commercial side. You know, that's my choice. But if that's your will, if you want to go out and live in the forest like a hermit, then, hey, I salute you. But that is not my choice.
No, I ain't trying to do that. One thing I had a question on because I was looking into it was, when I get to the point where I am a secured party creditor, is it possible for me to, like, let's say I go to a credit union, right, and I open up a line of credit as a secured party creditor, and I use my line of credit, I can just discharge that debt that I accrue to my line of credit being a secured party creditor? Is the kind of mindset that I think is how it works.
Right, I mean, allegedly you wouldn't actually be creating a debt because if you're a secured party, then and if I've done the packet for you, you're drawing off of that birth certificate and that bond. I mean, it's actually constructed in such a way that, I mean, you know, there's certain people that you're actually putting on notice, like a couple treasury departments, and they know that you're drawing off of that bond. So I don't see where you would actually go into, I'm not sure what you're thinking, like going to a bank, and I guess you was going to borrow money or something from them?
No, I guess let's say, because we talking now, I'm a secured party creditor. I don't have a job or anything like this, so I'm not getting, like, no paper bills. Let's say I do go, you know, become an unenumerated employee.
Right.
And I needed one of them, you know, one of them Visa cards or something to do something, that I can get the card as a creditor and use the card and discharge whatever, I guess, the debt that comes off of using the card.
Yeah, I've done that plenty of times.
Yeah, I want to know if that was possible, if that was I'm going in the right train of thought.
Yeah, I mean, credit cards are really easy to discharge, and most of them are not secured anyways. Like, most secured loans are pretty easy to discharge anyways. But, yeah, I just posted that link to the video in the room. If you're actually signed on to the internet, if you click on that link.
Yeah, I'm on the chat at the same time.
Yeah. If you click on the link that I just posted in the window, it'll actually take you to that video about the Gullah Wars. I kind of went in detail on that. But, yeah, so have you filed the UCC-1? Do you have that on file?
I went to send it in because I took it with me when I went to go get all the rest of my files notarized. And
right.
Since I was getting everything notarized, it was on the top. I didn't have the instruction paper with me, so it's all completely on me. I take full responsibility for it. But I didn't date the UCC-1 when I sent it in, so I sent my whole packet in, and they sent it back to me.
Well, you're not
and
supposed
took me,
yeah, I'll talk to you about this in private. You're not supposed
yeah.
to send anything in until you get the UCC-1 back, because you need that
okay.
filing number to put on certain other documents. But I don't want to discuss too much of this, like, over this line, you know?
Oh, all right.
Yeah, it's kind of...
Yeah, besides that, I'm getting, good information. Like you say, watch it over and over again, so it's good for me getting on here and hearing things I've already heard you say or heard, other people saying, getting that embedded into my subconscious so I can snap because I don't want to get cut. These snakes out here going to try to get me when I do this process. If I go out there, I'm going to be public enemy number one. So I want to make sure I got it on point.
No, the only thing you're doing is just changing your status. The only thing you're
yeah.
doing is notifying these people that, listen, I've changed my status. Like, I'm no longer an incompetent ward of the state. I'm competent to handle my own affairs. I'm no longer under your jurisdiction. I'm a man. I'm just a free man on the land. That's basically what you're doing. That's all you're doing. You're not asking for any type of permission or anything. You're just putting
okay.
certain documents on a public record.
And just letting them know.
Right.
Yeah, if I may
just
add
letting
in,
them know. My status has changed.
Yeah, if I may add in, when you, I think the master question is will anybody come knocking on my door for a file of UCC-1? You do not have to worry about any of that thing. No one's going to call you or nothing like that unless it's like someone says it's frivolous or something like that. But all the UCC-1 is that you're putting the public on notice. That's all it is. It's
totally
a notice. It's a notice. Now, you got the other documents and stuff like that. Now, the UCC-1 is the notice of the other documents that you have, whatever it is that you have backing up that UCC-1, your security agreement, the mortgage, whatever it is. But all it is a notice. So if someone else tries to, it's pretty much a notice of a lien. It's a notice of a lien. So if
guest eight, he's typing some stuff here in the room here. If you would, you could call in. If you have something that you actually might like to add, verbally. Because he's saying he's against the UCC-1. Sounds like one of the Moors, and I've actually heard that talk constantly. But then in turn, I get a lot of those people that turn to me for assistance. So, if you're against it, then hey.
Wait, someone's against the UCC-1?
Yeah, it's guest eight typing in the room. Since we've been on the call, in different topics.
Well.
if you would like to call in guest eight, the floor
I would
is
like
open.
To know.
We'll
like
welcome your call. He may be a Moor. A lot of Moors are actually against filing UCC-1, but I would say this, several Moors has actually turned to me for guidance and direction because a lot of people that join these mosques and temples are finding out that they're actually being, they're paying monthly dues, but they're really not running enough to, stay afloat in the sea of commerce. But that's a different topic. But, yeah. So, go ahead, Rocky, continue on, brother.
Yeah, it's pretty much just a notice. And a notice, when you say notice, you're just putting people on notice. Like, I'm notifying you. What does notification mean? You're telling somebody, say, hey, this is mine. I got a claim on it. It's mine. You don't touch it. If you do, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. That's all a notice is. It's saying that you have paramount, actually check out this word. You have a paramount security interest, or it's more like a phrase, but you have a paramount security interest. Paramount. You have the top claim. Because there's no claim higher than a commercial claim, except for like a maritime claim or something like that. But if someone tries to put a lien against you or against your straw man, not you, but your straw man or your legal fiction, your artificial person, the artificial person if you already have a lien on it, what happens is what the UCC does, if you file a lien or a notice against or for your legal fiction first, like if you do it on July 1st and July 3rd, someone else files a lien, like a bank or something like that, but because you defaulted in some payments and they put a lien against your property, because all you're doing, you're putting a lien against the property that the legal fiction owns. So when you, if you put the, like I said, they put the lien on you like July 3rd and you put it on July 1st, you have Paramount's lien. Your lien overrides their lien. So if they take your the collateral or the that they say is collateral or the property of the legal fiction and they try to sell it or something, you get paid first because you're first in the line, first in line, first in time. So, yeah, pretty much, yeah. That's pretty much what happens when you put a notice UCC-1. It's just a claim. It's just saying that you have a claim. And it's in public. It's a national record. It's in a national record. So you don't have to be afraid of doing it. But I said, it must be corrected. When you do file it, it has to be corrected. I mean, not corrected, perfected. It has to be. You have to have something backing it up because it's a notice. It doesn't do anything. It's the paperwork behind that. That means
something. Oh, yeah, we're going. Y'all got a whole bunch of them.
Say again? What happened? Hello?
Yeah, that was another call. I had opened up the line, so on. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I mean, you're good.
Yeah.
Guest 14. You have any questions or you have anything you'd like to add to the call? Guest 14, you just called in. You have any questions? Caller that just called in is guest 14. Do you have any questions?
Yes, hello, my brother.
Hey, shalom, brother. How you doing?
Yes, good, thanks. I have a question. The question is, since the system put you in an entity, put an entity on you, the private man, and they want you to sign contract, whatever contract they want you to sign, using the entity name, they are put in all caps. Is there a way for the private man to sign any one of those contracts and still be on the private side?
Well, I mean, you could always reserve your rights. When you reserve your rights on the contract, then anything that's actually above, you're reserving your rights. It's debatable and it's open for discussion. Another way, if there's anything in the contract that you don't agree with, you could strike a line through it. You don't agree with it. In order for a contract to be effective, there has to be a meeting of the minds, and there has to be agreement on both sides. So if you don't consent to the contract, and if you're coercing the signing the contract, then it's not, you know, a contract that's really totally effective or, in their words, like legal. There has to be a meeting of the minds. There has to be agreement on both sides. You know, one person can't be like insane, discombobulated, or the person can't be coerced into signing it. If you're coerced into signing a contract, then you can come back later and say, hey, I was forced to do this. I've done this in the protest and the rest. And then that changes the entire, you know, status of the contract.
Okay, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how you signed your name, whether all caps or upper and lower case, right?
Yeah, that doesn't matter. I mean, sometimes they'll just write your name out regularly because a lot of people have been talking about the uppercase name. So now they'll just write it some, like, just write your name regularly. But sometimes they'll write it upper and lower case.
I wouldn't be too thrown off by that. But if you sign the contract, then, you know, there's generally consent. Again, unless you're forced into doing it, or unless you signed it, you know, by deception. And most contracts that you sign is going to be a unilateral contract, is going to be in favor of the other side.
So the signature, to be on the safe side, let's say John Doe. The signature would be John Doe, all rights reserved. That's how you'd write it.
Well, I you know, you sign your signature, and I usually sign under my signature, like all rights reserved UCC-1-308. I'll generally sign like that. Generally, you sign my rights on everything, except for an affidavit. Of course, you don't want to do that on an affidavit because then it nullifies everything above that signature on the affidavit. That means it no longer applies. So you never want to reserve your rights on the affidavit.
Okay, thank you, my brother.
All right, thank you, brother. Anyone else have any questions or input? I just wanted to say, you know, there's a lot of people going around supposedly doing secured party creditors packages for people. And, you know, I've actually heard about a lot of people that actually been getting, you know, ripped off. They've been giving people money and, you know, they haven't been getting a package or nothing. So, you know, those of you that, you know, wanting to become a secured party creditor could definitely get that process done for you. If you shoot an email.
Hey, brother. Hello?
Yeah, how is love? You say shalom, peace, something like that. What's going on?
Excuse me? Hey, no, I called in early and I heard what you just said about people getting ripped off. And I just want to tell you I appreciate you because you provided a service for me and you did exactly what you said you was going to do. And I just want to tell you I appreciate that.
All right, brother. I appreciate that, letting you know, for letting
all
people
right.
know. I mean, I've just been hearing, you know, a lot of people been hitting me up saying, you know, I know most of you probably know of the Brother Polite. You know, he has some website called New Covenant. And a lot of people have been going there donating hundreds of dollars, you know. One brother told me he donated $550, another one $1,800. And they never heard back from the brother. Just took their money. And, you know, I'm told, I haven't seen the video myself, that the brother's living out somewhere in Beverly Hills, driving a Bentley. This, you know, just taking folks' monies and just leaving. So, I mean, you know, if you're going to do this, then, you know, you want to do it through someone that you can really trust. So, and any kind of negative energy that anyone sends out towards anyone is going to come back to you. Not necessarily through that particular person, but that negative energy will come back towards you. So I just try and stay on a positive level of vibration and operate from that frequency. So any kind of negative energy, if you're ripping people off or doing things to them like that, that energy will be back to you. That's just the law of attraction. That's just the way the universe works. But, yeah, I appreciate that, brother. Hey, brother, Larky, you got anything else, brother?
Yeah, I kind of wanted to touch on that a little bit. Not on the issue itself, but pretty much the principle of it, that if you do some things that is contrary to elevation or development, I should say, when, you know, the purpose or in most cases, the purpose is to develop in whatever it is that you do. And if you don't know what you do, you know, figure out what you do. And if you like what you do, develop in it, provided that it's for the greater good of mankind, if you will, for the planet itself, or, you know, and for yourself, your family, your nation, your society, your community, and all these things, because when I got into this stuff, I was introduced to it in the circumstances of being in a crisis. But as I started to develop within it, or to develop myself to understand it more, I realized that this information, this stuff can be used to help people and to help rebuild what has been already defaced and destroyed and mutated and all these things that have made it out of sync with nature. So the goal should be to increase the amount of persistence in developing nature or developing your environment, because you are within your environment. The planet itself is a house, whether you look at it like that or not. But you could say you live in your house, but if your house wasn't there, or if the earth wasn't there, you wouldn't have a house. So the house, the planet itself is a house. It's a home. This house that you turn into a home. You see, so you have to take care of it, or her, and most you might say Mother Nature, or whatever, if you want to go that far. But take care of your home. And the only way you can truly do that is to take care of yourself and take care of your brother and sister by providing them with the proper and the correct material or the correct idea, or at least spark their mind to do it from within themselves, which that should be the goal, is to bring the light back, you know, and to bring back the torch, so to speak, that has literally been snatched out of your hands. So you have to bring that back and bring everything back into synchronicity. And you have the power to do it just by influencing your own surroundings, your own environment. Create a positive environment, or create an environment that is suitable for other people to be around. You see, and then you do that, the next person does that, then the next person after that person does that, next thing you know, we got a clean planet, clean water, clean food, real water, real clothes, without stuff all in them and stuff like that. We become self-sufficient. We become predators, but on a different level. Because you can't necessarily eliminate the debtor in this society, but there's always going to be a debtor and a creditor, because someone's always giving and someone is always receiving. So there's always going to be a debtor and a creditor in a sense, but that doesn't mean that you have to be a victim. As most debtors, that's pretty much the capacity of most debtors. So if you're about evolving and getting out of the particular situation you're in, then you should try to develop from within yourself and blossom for who you really are, because you're not a secure party creditor. You're not this flesh that you have, but you are it that keeps it moving. And once you understand that, and you reconnect yourself, bring everything back together to remember. You have to remember who you are, because you have been dismembered. So once you do these things, you will see improvement in your life. You will no longer hate your neighbor. You might get irritated, but you won't necessarily hate them as much. It won't affect you as well. Things will start to better. The planet will start to get better. Your environment will start to get better. And then you can be sovereign, truly sovereign, because you need land to be sovereign. Your land right now has been compromised, and it's been degraded and degenerated. It's up to you, it's all up to all of us, it's our duty, it's our obligation to bring back the harmony that was once at its pinnacle. The planet was once at its pinnacle, and we need to elevate it back even farther, or at least ourselves. Make ourselves better than who we are or who we were that made us or got us into this predicament that we're in. So
Yeah, that's all I have to say.
Anyone else have anything they would like to add? Any more questions? Anyone with any kind of input?
Yes, I have a simple question.
All right.
My brother, you said when you signed your name with reserving your right with UCC 1-308, and you do that above the line, could you explain to me again what the body of the instrument, your signature, how does it affect the body of the instrument they gave you to be a party of?
I'm sorry, you kind of lost me there for a second, brother. What was the last part of that?
Okay, when you're signing a contract, right? And these contracts are governed by statute codes and whatever is in their offer, and you're signing it, and you sign with all reserving your rights on the UCC 1-308, and you sign it above the line. How does it affect the body of the letter itself? The contract itself in words.
You said you sign it above the line. I don't understand what you mean there. You sign it above the line. Above what line?
Okay, where they ask you for your signature.
Okay.
Right. And you write John Doe, reserve all rights to UCC 1-308. No, how does it affect the contract itself in wording?
I mean, you're still good. You still put that you reserve your rights to. You mean
right.
you put it adjacent to your signature? You put it above your signature or under your signature?
Okay. So the line has nothing to do with it, either above or below the line. Are you saying?
Well, I always sign below my signature or adjacent to my signature. I haven't put it, you know, above my signature. I'm not saying that you can't. I'm just saying I don't sign it that way.
Oh, okay. All right,
yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, brother.
Well,
is there anyone else that has any more questions before we bring this one to a close? So, brother, looks like there's no more questions. So, I mean, we can go ahead and bring this to a close. It's like almost 8:30. You must have got kicked out of the call. Have you got anything else, Law?
Yeah, my bad, brother. Yeah, man, I dropped off. Sorry about that. Excuse me.
Yeah. So you got anything else? If not, we can go ahead and bring this one to an end. It's been on almost 2 hours, about 5 minutes shy of 2 hours. No one else has any more questions?
Yeah, I'm open to questions if anyone have any. If not, then...
So no more questions. We'll probably tune in here next week, same time, 8:30 Eastern Standard Time. I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in. Again, if you would like to get the secured party creditor process started, you could just reach out. And until next week, everybody be safe. I'm going to say shalom, peace.